Today, I'm down here on the coast in search of a very unusual looking animal, which has some pretty cool structural and behavioural adaptations, which has allowed it to survive in this ever-changing coastal environment. But first, I have to wait for this tide to come in, because for this fish, it's feeding time. The environment I'm exploring today is commonly known as the sand flats and forms part of the much larger intertidal zone. The sand flats are often protected from strong wind and waves. The salt water from the ocean moves in with the tides, covering hundreds of metres of sand flats twice a day. In this environment, it's often the tide that influences the behaviour of the animals that call this intertidal zone their home. At low tide, the sand flats will often appear lifeless. But in fact, they are home to all kinds of animals, including burrowing worms, crabs, yabbies, and seabirds. There's such a diversity of life. It's not hard to see why so many fish come up onto these sand flats and feed at high tide. And a great example of this are these soldier crabs. There are literally thousands of them out here on these sand flats. And this is just one of the animals that the fish will come up here to feed on. But as that tide rises, many of these soldier crabs will bury safely down in the sand. Well, so they think. As the tide begins to change, so do the animals that move into this environment. On the incoming tide, fish, crabs and even sharks will start to move across the flats to feed and hunt during the high tide. And it's for this very reason I've chosen to go fishing on the incoming tide. So the animal we're actually looking for today is responsible for creating all these holes you see across the sand flats at low tide. All right, my next challenge is to find one. Come on. That's right, the animal we're going to investigate today is the smooth-swimming stingray. Now, the first thing you notice about a stingray is his large, round, flattened body. Now, it's this flat body shape that allows the stingray to swim right into the shallows to catch prey, but also avoid predators. Now, a stingray's skeleton is made entirely of cartilage. That's similar to the stuff your nose and your ears are made out of. And you're probably wondering, why would a stingray want a skeleton made of cartilage? Well, you see, cartilage is a lot lighter than bone, and it gives the stingray a great deal of flexibility and maneuverability when chasing prey and avoiding predators. Now, it's this flattened body shape and large muscular pectoral fins that allow the stingray to actually glide, almost swim effortlessly through the water. It's a great way to conserve energy. Now, stingrays can swim very fast, but they're not very buoyant, so they don't float very well. But they actually use this to their advantage. When they feel threatened, they can quickly sink to the bottom of the ocean floor and remain there motionless for several hours. Now, this kind of behavioural adaptation actually conserves valuable energy, which they can expend later either chasing prey or fleeing a predator. The stingray has a pretty cool way of feeding on the ocean floor. While laying in the sand, they will use their large disc-shaped body to create a suction between their flattened body and the sand. And this suction is so powerful, it's actually able to draw up prey and crustaceans and fish deep within the sand and right into their mouths. Now, it's this suction and movement of sand which created those holes we saw on the sand flats earlier today. He truly is the master of the sand flats.
Stingrays have also developed another adaptation that allows them to successfully live and breathe on the ocean floor. A stingray's gills are located on the underside of their body, so while buried in the sand, their ability to pass water through their gills can be quite challenging. So they use two structures known as spiracles, which are small round openings positioned just behind their eyes. These spiracles are used to draw in oxygenated water from above, pumping it down through the gills, allowing the stingray to breathe while remaining motionless in the sand.
Now, the stingray is the master of camouflage, and when lying in the sand, they will use these large pectoral fins to flick sand up onto their back.
and this allows the stingray to blend right into their environment. And their skin often mimics the colour of the ocean floor, almost making the stingray invisible to incoming predators. Because stingrays live predominantly on the ocean floor, their eyes are situated in a pretty convenient location. They're right on top of their head. Now, this allows the stingray to see in almost all directions. It also gives it the ability to feed on the ocean floor while simultaneously looking out for predators above. Now, the stingray gets its name from a particular part of its tail known as the stinger. And it's an extremely sharp, serrated, venomous spine. And it's the stingray's only form of defense. And it's used to fend off and deter large predators like sharks. And just looking at these razor-sharp edges, it looks capable of inflicting a painful and serious wound. Now, that's one lethal weapon. Because the stingray's habitat is close to the coast and they spend a lot of their times in the shallows, they were often encountered by Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people and valued as an important food source. As well as being an important food source, many Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people also observed just how sharp and effective this stingray barb was, so much so that they actually used this barb to improve their very special fishing tools. Now, I know just the place where I can show you one of these special fishing tools. But first, I've got to let this young stingray go for his high tide hunt. And I've got to go find some dry clothes. Come on, mate. There we go. So, Joe, what do we have here?
Phil, this is a what they call a kek walk. It's a Wikmunkan spear. Would you believe it's over 100 years old already? It came into the Queensland Museum in 1914, and it has a very specialised spearhead, and the head on this spear has about 16 stingray barbs embedded into it.
They've taken 16 of those barbs from stingrays and then fastened it to the end of the spear.
That's correct. When a stingray defends itself and uses its barb in defence, when it pierces your skin, it is very hard to get out of your skin. On each side of it is a row of recurved barbs, and they're designed to go in and to make it very hard to come back out, and it's designed to make a significant injury.
So what you're saying here, this would make the perfect spear tip?
100%. So these are a surefire way of ensuring that if you're skilled enough to hit the fish that you're hunting, that it's unlikely to be able to shake off the end of the spear.
In my travels, I swear I've seen either wooden spears or even bone carved to almost mimic this exact shape. Is there a chance that this may have inspired the very design of some wooden spears?
Yep, many people feel that when they do look at those wooden spears that have this same shape, that they often see the connection to stingray barbs for that shape and design. I mean, considering stingrays have been around a lot longer than humans, you know, we're talking stingrays being around for many millions of years before humans, they've had a long time to solve the problem and make sure that this is an effective weapon and device.
Joe, this spear and these barbs is such a great example of how, by observing nature, and in this case, the stingray, Aboriginal people were able to improve essential tools and weaponry. And I'd say this is probably not the last time humans look to nature for inspiration.
Yep, and that's the fundamental approach of biomimicry.
The stingray's barb is an impressive structural adaptation. With its intimidating design and durable strength, it's no surprise that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people use this barb to improve their fishing spears. The stingray is a great example of how an animal's behavioural and structural adaptations have allowed it to survive and live successfully on the coastal environment. For all animals, adaptations are essential for life. They allow them to hunt, reproduce, move and hide, and without them, most animals would not survive.